Hi, I'm Joshua McKenty. I do stuff with cloud software. How many of you know anything about Cloud Foundry? How many of you have used it before? Oh, sweet, okay. They gave me a ridiculous amount of time, an extended session, I think with the idea that I would cover a whole bunch of material. I think they made a mistake and assumed that I knew a lot of stuff. My guess is you're a very mixed audience, and some of you don't know anything, and some of you want to know something about how the Go router works dealing with SSL certificates or something super specific. So I'm going to try and do a mix of things and make everybody slightly unhappy as opposed to anyone all the way happy and other people really upset. So I'll do like a very short little high level thing, and then some technical architecture stuff. And then we can either do demos or hands-on labs, depending on if people have laptops handy, and lots of Q&A, because Q&A is way more fun than me being up here talking. You know those talks that you go to where the presenter's super prepared and the slides are beautiful, and you're like, wow, that was the best talk I've ever been to? This is not one of those. My flight was extremely delayed last night, so I've had like 3 hours of sleep. And I've done 4 hours presenting already today. So I'm basically totally incoherent. Good news is I do nothing but talk about Cloud Foundry, so this is mostly just me being incoherent anyway. And for those of you who don't know my background, I was one of the co-founders of OpenStack. I used to work at NASA. I served on the OpenStack Foundation board for a long time. So I have really strong opinions about open source that are mostly probably provably false. But that's okay. Cloud Foundry is not much like OpenStack, so that makes it easier. We have way more users than developers, which is cool. I'm teasing myself. Nobody gets these jokes. It's okay. The point of Cloud Foundry is to enable continuous delivery, and anyone who says otherwise is trying to sell you something. I'm also trying to sell you something, but that's what I'm trying to sell you. I worked on Netscape years and years ago as the tech lead for a couple of years, and the product manager had this sign on his door, and we just looked at it every day and said, oh yeah, right, the point of software is to exist. If you don't ship it, you failed. And one of the confusions about platform, what we now like to call platform instead of platform as a service, because that was confusing, is that it's about development. And platform done properly, and by which I mean Cloud Foundry, is about both development and operations. You should be using the same set of tools for both. Otherwise, you're really only solving a small part of the problem. And I see this all the time. One of my favorite stories with Cloud Foundry is folks who say, yeah, we've been doing Agile for years. We have a sprint, and we finish and we demo code every 2 weeks. I was like, oh, how often do you ship that to prod? Once every 9 months. So that's like, what's the point? Like literally, why bother? Just go back to doing waterfall, because then you're developing software at the same cadence you're releasing it to production. It's less of an impedance mismatch. I haven't seen anyone from HP here. It's an old habit of mine to make fun of HP. I think it comes from the OpenStack days. So it's not HP specifically, but a lot of people in IT believe that their purpose in life is to keep the printers working. And that mindset just like permeates whether they're developers or operators or network people or security people, like their worldview is it's about keeping the printers on the network. And so I like to think of what would it be like in the days when IT is about more than printers. So this is a super quick, high-level thing. Everyone's heard about this software is eating the world thing. What does that mean? It means actually we used to have the S&P 500 meant big, stable companies that would be around for like 75 to 100 years and be important. They're now on average 18 years on the S&P 500, and that's dropping. We've got these sort of new companies emerging. All of these dollar values, by the way, are wrong, so you can see how fast this industry is changing. When was the last time Uber was worth $19 billion? Right, it's like way over 50 now. But Uber didn't exist a few years ago. So a lot of the folks who are using Cloud Foundry are using it, their old stodgy companies, using it to respond to dramatic change. The folks who are quote unquote disrupting them are not using Cloud Foundry because they built their own platform. That is the definition of who they are as a company. So, you know, Allstate is a big Cloud Foundry user. They've been really public about it. And it's because Google decided to become an insurance company. And so every insurance company in the world got immediately terrified. Because like Google can come up with an idea for an insurance product on Monday and have it in production on Friday. Allstate comes out with a new product every 2 years. They're like, well, by the time we get our first product out, we won't even be in business anymore because Google will have taken all of our customers. So this idea of going fast to keep up is sort of really well stated by a friend of mine, Andrew Clay Schaefer, who is mostly known as the most angry man in cloud. He was also one of the co-founders of Puppet, so he's been around this sort of space for a while. And he points out, either you're a software company or you're losing to a software company. All right, that was the high level thing, and I told the Netscape story already. The other thing that people get hung up on, and this comes up every time I start talking about Cloud Foundry, people are like, oh, as soon as you say the word middleware, because I'm going to say the word middleware, I'm going to say Cloud Foundry is cloud middleware, they think that it needs to replace WebLogic and therefore do all the things that WebLogic does. That's not what I mean by middleware. If you focus on something that solves the legacy problems you already have, you're skating to where the puck used to be. I'm just going to use all these metaphors because I'm tired and so I can't say anything original. But, you know, 10 years ago, most companies had like three apps, right? They had like ERP and CRM and payroll. And they had just as many people in IT, but all those people were just running those three applications. Now, on average, they have like 300. And some of them are really boring and some of them are kind of cool and they got the website in there. By the end of this decade, within 5 years, they're going to have 3,000. Because that's what's happening when you have to become a software company. You have to write a lot more software. So stop worrying about the 300 you have and start worrying about the 2,700 you're about to write. Okay, that was the high-level businessy part for those of you that are high-level businessy people. I'm going to take my suit jacket off now. We talk about rate of change, and just so keep in the back of your mind, this is the problem we're solving for. How do you deploy into production all the time, all of your applications, all of your services? And how many of you are familiar with 12-factor? Okay. I'll tiny recap it, but it looks like, and microservices, roughly? Okay, about the same. Great. So I don't have to belabor the point. When I was at NASA writing OpenStack, I didn't want to be writing OpenStack. I was hired to write a PaaS, and we just didn't have anything to run it on. So I got distracted into building IaaS for like 5 years, which is 5 years of my life I will never get back. But the reality, the realization at the time was we needed something different because the tools we had were not going to solve the problems we had. And so I like to pick on Puppet because Andrew's a friend of mine and he likes to pick on OpenStack, and so it feels fair. 10 years ago, we invented Puppet. And in the intervening 10 years, we have invented big data, cloud, social, and mobile for all intents and purposes as like hard tech problems. The Apple App Store launch really created the mobile app ecosystem. I mean, we had apps before that, but not really. Facebook really created social in terms of being a place where you had to go write apps and APIs you had to go integrate with, compared to, let's say, MySpace before that. You know, Hadoop really created the big data ecosystem in a meaningful fashion, although we did have BI before that. We had data warehousing. We didn't have big data the way we have it now. And Amazon, kind of for all intents and purposes, invented cloud. All of that has happened since we invented Puppet. So if you think about it, the problems that Puppet was built to solve were not those problems. The other way to think about them is that in the future, every app we write is a distributed system. We have to expect it's going to run on more than one server, and it's going to deal with more than one user at once, which is a different technical problem than a get this server and this app on this one server into this state guaranteed, which is idempotency. Idempotency is brilliant. It's really important. It's still a concept we use. But it was the problem we had 10 years ago. The problem we have today is distributed systems management. All right, in terms of PaaS, so we're all using the term the same way. Everyone's seen the pizza diagram. Everyone steals the same pizza diagram, right? So you got your traditional IT, you got your infrastructure as a service where people bring you the cheese and the toppings and the pizza dough. You got your platform as a service where they actually deliver pizza to you. You still eat it at home, as opposed to SaaS, where you eat in a restaurant, you don't even have to do dishes. I said before, you know what, this is, okay. This is what I think PaaS is. Skipping over the businessy parts, you've got some collection of bits, some code, and you want it to be a running system that can scale in some interesting ways. You'll notice there's no part of this diagram that says container or virtual machine or socket or Docker. Those are implementation details. At a high level, platform can be built with any of those, or none of them. Could use something else. So in Cloud Foundry, specifically, the runtime component can use all sorts of different primitives. It can use containers, it can use Docker containers, it can use guarding containers, which are a native Cloud Foundry format. It can use Windows IIS processes, if you're running .NET apps. It can use, I don't know, bare metal, dedicated servers. It could be, like, the abstraction is, we're scheduling stuff, we don't care. Now, there are some usefulness to using containers, and I'll talk about why we do, but it's not inherent in PaaS. All right, Cloud Foundry is open source, and that's why we're at All Things Open talking about it, and that seems super cool. How many of you like open source? How many of you have arms? Same number of people, okay. Just checking. Some major things about it, it's supported by lots of organizations. I'm a big fan of multi-vendor open source, and this is, like I said before, I'm an OpenStack guy, so I have religion that's provably wrong, but I deal mostly with Fortune 100, Fortune 500 governments that run Cloud Foundry, right? So Korea, the country of Korea. They run OpenStack, they also run Cloud Foundry. The US government runs Cloud Foundry in a bunch of places. They run this thing called cloud.gov. That's Cloud Foundry on top of Amazon. And they have a very different attitude about open source than we do. We work in open source. We care about open source for personal reasons, for emotional reasons. They care about it for very pragmatic reasons. To them, open source is something that they can buy from more than one vendor. See, I can buy some of this from, in the case of Cloud Foundry, I can buy it from IBM, I can buy it from Pivotal, I can buy it from HP, I can use it open source. They like having more than one vendor that they can buy the same bits from. It makes them feel safe. It means they can check off that little box that says, I got three quotes. And so it makes it easier to build an ecosystem around. So Cloud Foundry has a bunch of organizations. That Cloud Foundry Foundation also has a lot of customer and user members. So we think of, you know, Bloomberg, JP Morgan Chase, the country of Korea, as being key members of that foundation. So not everybody involved is a vendor, and a lot of the folks involved as members aren't even contributors necessarily, could just be users. I like the idea of users as contributors, right? What they're contributing is their understanding of how it works, filing bugs. Okay, it's language and framework agnostic, by which I mean it's not just Java or just .NET or just PHP. I think of first generation PaaS, most of them as being one language at a time. So we'll talk about how Cloud Foundry does that under the hood. But if you take the community as a whole, I think you can run 50 or 60 different languages and frameworks in Cloud Foundry, everything from Scala to Erlang to Ruby to Node to .NET. And this is the one that everyone misses, it runs both virtual machines and containers. That one's super important to me. And so I'm going to belabor that point a little bit. Is everyone like, are you with me so far? Okay. In the magic world of post-2005, when we have cloud and overnight, maybe your app is ridiculously popular like Flappy Bird, and you got millions of people hitting your app and you don't want it to go down because you're making $50,000 an hour in selling this app. Those apps, in order to scale well, need to be stateless. And everybody sort of mostly agrees with this, and why, and what it means. But an app that has no state at all is boring. It's not interesting. So you do need state. It's not that we got rid of state. It's that we took it out of the app and we put it into what we call data. So it's just an abstraction. State still has to live somewhere. And it turns out that the place of last resort for state is disk. You can have it in memory, and that's really cool until you lose power, and then you don't have any state anymore, and it's sad. And in theory, you can actually store state in SMTP retries. I don't know how many of you have actually used that as a file system. It does work. It's fairly durable. It's very, very slow. Not a lot of IOPS. So disk matters. And right now, disk in the container ecosystem is pretty immature. It's coming along. I wouldn't use it. It's similar to how for a long time people thought you needed a NetApp. You don't really. Is anyone in here from NetApp? I'm going to be mean to you for a minute. Oh, I'm sorry. There you go. Is HP next to you too? It's the firing line. You need some disk somewhere, but you don't necessarily need expensive disk anymore. And we have smart software. We've got Ceph. We've got Gluster. We've got whatever you want, Swift or some kind of storage. But that storage today, if it looks like a block, is best attached to a VM. Also, networking on containers is still an area of growth. Since I have the time to belabor this point, I'm going to. How many of you have heard of Gopher Rage? Okay, cool, you're learning something. No, not an angry gopher. It's an NSA project that was part of the Snowden stuff, that it is essentially a PCI bus mastering exploit, right? Of which there are a bunch. I like to mention Gopher Rage because it was developed using Agile, and I thought that was funny. If you have bus mastering, by which you're not inside a VM, and you have actual access to hardware, or you're using something like LSPCI, so you have pass-through to the PCI bus, there are a family of exploits that allow you to exploit the video card BIOS, the hard drive controller firmware, the BIOS of the physical machine, etc. And we don't have any good way to patch those. Like, the hard drive controller exploits are a flaw in the SATA spec. So what you want is to use a VM. Like, and I've been quoted as saying this, so it's no surprise, like, VMs are the condoms of the internet, right? Which is like a decent concept if you think about it. Don't let untrusted code touch your bus. So we'll leave that one there. Okay, so Cloud Foundry has orchestration for both VMs and containers, and it uses different concepts for these two kinds of orchestration. I'm going to get into this, but the virtual machine orchestration is this thing called Bosch. Now, if you have a laptop open, you want to go to bosch.io and bookmark it, because some of the Cloud Foundry community members describe the learning curve of Bosch as a 100-foot straight up cliff. It's like, it is hopelessly complex. And until your mind kind of goes, oh, I get it, you're like, why the hell am I putting up with this pain? So let me walk you through what Bosch is. Everything you do with apt, plus everything you do with Puppet, plus everything you do with maybe Terraform, plus some other stuff that you don't even know how to do reliably, like Monit jobs and things, all of that is in Bosch. And it ends up looking like a source tree and a YAML file, which means it actually compiles your source code, packages it, runs jobs that deploys those packages onto VMs, starts the processes, monitors them, checks the responses coming off of their various ports to make sure they're doing the right things. It does this for multiple VMs. It assigns IP addresses. It sets up configuration of other services to talk to those IP addresses. Like, literally, everything that you think you need for orchestration of VMs in an IaaS environment is in Bosch. And it's actually really the only reliable thing I've been working in cloud for a stupid amount of time. And I used to do this by hand on Amazon along with everyone else using some combination of Bash and Python. And there are literally dozens of tools in that space. Most of them are traditional configuration management applied to something that is not traditional configuration management. So I'm going to belabor this point a little bit more. This is what I like about having a long slot. I just get to like drill in. On the VM side, the definition of platform is narrow artificial intelligence. I'm going to give you the pathological case, okay? Let's say that you want to run a Galera cluster, as many people do, in VMs, in an IaaS, so that you could run it on Amazon, or you could run it on vSphere, or you could run it on OpenStack, or you could run it on Azure. And as a developer, you don't care. You're not thinking about how that's being done. It just gets done for you. And you want it to, you know, run somewhere between 7 and 10 VMs. And you want it to always have quorum. And let's say you want it to be able to do an automated scale down. It's pathologically worst case. Okay? So you want it to go from running 9 VMs down to 7 VMs. And during that scale down, excuse me, I'm stuffy for some reason. During that scale down, your master VM dies. If you are using traditional configuration management, and I don't care which tool, Chef, Ansible, Puppet, Salt, Juju maybe, you're toast. Either your scale down is going to complete and you're going to catastrophically lose data, or it is going to not complete and then your CM system has no idea what system state you're in. And the reason is because configuration management, the best configuration management in the world, is still a script. It is a script that is a set of actions expected to happen and always happen and repeatedly happen. And it pulls in, you know, data bag configuration values and whatever else, but it is not fundamentally system aware. It's process aware and server aware. That's the primitives. So what Bosch has internally is a state database. And when you update a Bosch manifest and you say, instead of having 9 VMs, I want to have 7 VMs, what you're doing is updating the Bosch state database to say the desired system state is X. Bosch is then going to look at the actual system state, which it is doing continuously, and say, oh, actual system state and desired system state don't match. Therefore, I need state transitions. I'm going to create and then execute a set of state transitions to get from actual state towards desired state. And I'll keep doing that as long as it keeps converging. And if it doesn't converge, I'll exponentially back off and eventually give up and alert an operator. Yeah?
At some point, aren't you just substituting state transitions for script?
No, and here's why.
At some point, an SSH has to be employed to go to the server to do the thing.
At some point, a Bosch agent has to be contacted by a director. Yes? Because a script is declarative ahead of time. It's not state aware. So if your actual state permutes, in other words, your master is gone, Bosch is going to say, I don't know how to generate a state transition that goes from this to scale down, because the starting state does not match an allowable state for a transition.
So it knows it's broken.
It knows it's broken ahead of time. It says, stop everything, stop scaling down, because the master's missing. We don't want to scale down because we might take out the master that's just been reelected by Galera. So that conceptual difference is what makes it really hard for people to look at Bosch and understand Bosch, because they're like, why does this have to be so hard? Why am I doing all of these things to describe the desired relationship between the components instead of how I imagine that relationship should be achieved? And that's really what you're doing. In Bosch, you're saying, I want these components to have this relationship. Not, I think you should do these things to get there. Because you have to let Bosch decide what to do. Now, what you get out of that is, if you run, let's say, Cloud Foundry on top of Amazon, which lots of people do, we run it for Pivotal Web Services, the GSA runs it, Amazon's gonna lose your VM sooner or later, right? 2% per month on average, something like that, your VM's gonna die. And Bosch is gonna notice. Bosch is gonna say, oh, I thought you were supposed to have 4 VMs running log aggregation servers, and there's only 3. I'm going to start a new one, get the log aggregation job running It'll get a dynamic IP, I'll see what that is. I'll update the load balancers to know about that IP. I'll update all of the Metreon agents to be pointed to that IP. And I'll actually reattach the EBS volume that was there before and run this sort of FISC script if required, right? So by the time the operator notices that they've got an alert saying, hey, your VM went away, Bosch has already fixed it. Like, it's really weird. It's cool, but really weird. It's not just if the VM goes away. It's if the process on the VM dies. Or if the process is still running, but it's not answering on the port anymore. So there's a bunch of different evil ways that things fail. And cleanly failing is not usually the hard one to deal with. What's hard is the, for whatever reason, the process is still running, but I'm not getting the right response. So Bosch will actually terminate your VM if it can't resurrect the process. It'll try it through Monit, say, oh, I killed the process, it came back up, it's still not responding. Therefore, let's tear the whole VM down, build another one, inject the job. If it still doesn't work, we probably should give up. Justin Ehrenkranz, who's the CTO at Bloomberg, likes to run the entirety of open source Cloud Foundry and open source OpenStack, including a Ceph cluster, on his laptop. And he was pointing out one time that he was like trying to get some really complicated upgrade to happen, and he'd done a bunch of different Bosch deploys. This is when he was first trying to learn about Bosch, and he's like, I just kept Bosch deploying and changing the manifest and Bosch deploying. And so all of these tasks got scheduled by Bosch, and the database, the state database, got set up with all of these things he'd pushed in as manifests. He was like thinking script-wise, like, oh, I ran the script and nothing happened. No, what happened was you told Bosch that that was desired state. And like 6 hours later, Bosch had perfectly converged the system on his entire lap. And the thing was, it was like flaky Wi-Fi, and so he wasn't reliably getting IP. So Bosch would just keep trying, backing off and trying. And eventually he got all these VMs running and all these services running on them, and he like came back in the morning, he's like, it was done by itself. Like, he had left it open and given up, and Bosch is like, no, I never give up. I will make your cloud. So Bosch is pretty cool. I'm a fan. It's terrifying to learn, but you should really like lean into it. I mentioned the foundation. I should show you a slide. There's a bunch of people. Nobody really cares about this. It's like, there's a bunch of people writing code. This is actually 6 months old. It's like way more people than that now. Okay. I mentioned the containers aren't enough, right? People sort of get the idea of why containers aren't enough. I just like to use this photo, but it's mean. There's another way of thinking about it, which is less about state and more about abstraction. If you have a virtual resource, if you have a virtual machine or a virtual network or a virtual block device, you're thinking about hardware, virtual hardware, but you're thinking about hardware. I started programming in 83, and I was 6 years old, and I didn't know anything about hardware, and I didn't have to. I had an Apple II Plus, and when you turned it on with no disk in it, you got a basic prompt, and you could type code and it would work. And I didn't know, I never knew anything about flip-flops, I didn't really need to know anything about that stuff. What happens when you go from being like single process, single server, to distributed systems, is you have to know all this stuff. The developers all of a sudden have to know all this stuff about networking. And it's not fun. Networking is not fun. I mean, maybe it's fun for networking engineers. I don't like networking. It's painful. Weird things happen. It's like quantum. Like, how does that even work? And so the IaaS is still thinking about hardware. And that's why I used to say, look, when we started OpenStack, the purpose of OpenStack was to be able to run Cloud Foundry. I don't think people should use IaaS. I think platforms should use IaaS. Like, it's an API abstraction of hardware. Other software should talk through the APIs. It was not supposed to be a replacement for a GUI. The PaaS is fun to use. It's like, I think about my software. I think about the application I'm writing, and I give it to the platform, and it does stuff for me. It thinks about virtual machines. It thinks about networks. So you make a bunch of promises at the IaaS layer. You say, hey, I will give you this virtual machine, and I don't even look inside it. I promise not to look inside it. And therefore, there's a limit to what it can do. It can do post-hoc configuration, but it can't do kind of baked in. So you gotta let the VM boot first and then you can do things to it, right? That's not how a platform works. Platform says, I'm gonna look at your source code. I'm gonna figure out what language it's in, what services you require, and I'm gonna deploy it for you. I'm gonna do all this configuration before I start your process. All right, I mentioned it's agnostic to languages. It's also agnostic to IaaS, right? It's important. You can run it on top of OpenStack or Amazon or vSphere or somebody's got a cloud stack driver. Bosch also owns that piece. There's a thing in Bosch called the CPI, the Cloud Provider Interface. And it turns out you need about 15 API calls to have an IaaS that's good enough for Cloud Foundry. So if you implement those 15 API calls in a Cloud Provider Interface abstraction, Bosch can then use it. So we've had people write all sorts of crazy CPIs to drive bare metal servers, to drive remedy tickets. You actually could have a meet cloud where Bosch scheduled remedy tickets and then people stood up VMs by hand and then gave IP addresses back to Bosch. That would work. Timeouts would be a little extreme, but. And I mentioned it drives VMs. When you can drive VMs, you can drive the data services too. So Cloud Foundry has, you know, MySQL, Redis, Rabbit, Postgres, Hadoop, Jenkins, GitLab, Artifactory, all of these common services you get like push button access to. And not just like single VM versions or single container versions, but like durable, scaled out, orchestrated, including block volumes being removed and added, lifecycle managed data services. It's pretty cool. All right, I am going to jump a little bit. Any questions so far? Is this making sense at a high level? What it is, why people think it's cool? All right. No? I got like, when you break it?
Yeah, what happens when, I mean, because what you're doing is, at least in my head,
yeah.
We're just shuffling. What happens when the customer breaks off?
So here's the interesting thing. It's a little bit similar to, oh, so the question is, what happens when the customer breaks Bosch? Ah, but they're not. This is the difference. It's the same with OpenFlow, separation of control plane and data plane, right? So your data plane, if you like, is the running VMs. So if Bosch is dead, your VMs are still running. If it's the same separation as the IaaS control plane and the hypervisor. As long as your hypervisor's up, your VMs are up. Whether or not you can provision new ones or turn them off, that API layer might be down. So, and this is the same is true with Cloud Foundry as well. Bosch, the Bosch director could be dead. Usually run at HA, you actually can totally lose Bosch and rediscover system state from what's there. And it's actually Bosch itself, a lot of it is a distributed system, right? So the health monitor runs as a separate component, separate HA component from the director, which runs separately from monit on each VM. So the orchestration of that is all, well, today it's on this thing called NATS, which is annoying. We will get rid of NATS. The community was getting rid of NATS and going to something more, more of a console, etcd, zookeeper kind of model. So is it really just moving the point of failure? I don't think so because of the separation between control plane and data plane. That's true. Yeah, you can. I mean, you can go and launch more VMs that are not Bosch managed on the IaaS, and they'll sit there. Bosch doesn't have any way to adopt them.
Right.
Right.
So what happens?
Well, it's like it's the same as saying what happens when you break your app server. When you break your app server, you can't do an app get.
Then your data plane is there. When you break the server, you break what's serving your application.
No. An apt server in order to install packages. An apt server. If you broke your apt server, you couldn't do a package upgrade. You would fix your apt server before you wanted to do an upgrade. Same thing with Bosch.
So the thing that, and I've never heard of Bosch before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
So when it breaks, and God knows customers will break it.
Yeah, I mean,
all of your workflows, not just the provisioning workflow, not just an update workflow, not just something this that workflow, all of your workflows.
As Josh said, you can actually cover everything from the.
I mean, it's an interesting point to say all of your workflows in a single tool means right. When the tool is broken, you have no workflows. Interesting. No, it's not. Because systemd and sysinit are both sys5, right? You have to have the thing that runs the system.
The philosophy behind it is systemd controls too much, therefore I don't want to use systemd. Bosch controls all of them.
Bosch is like the systemd of cloud. That I would give you that. So if you have a philosophical objection to all eggs in one basket and you want to use a bunch of different tools, I could see that argument. Bloomberg has done some of that. They have some stuff done with Chef and some stuff done with Bosch, and they figured out how to make those things play nice. Canonical has used Juju to deploy Cloud Foundry, and they don't use Bosch, right? And actually, Staccato, before they were bought by HP, had their own deployer installer thing called Kato instead of Bosch. It's like the largest Cloud Foundry deployments in the world use Bosch, and so I tend to think like it's a pretty effective tool. Like, that argument is certainly legitimate, right? If you don't want all your workflows in one basket. But the advantage of that is your deployment workflows and your update workflows and your scale up and scale down workflows are aware of each other, right? So your total system state is valuable. All right, I'm gonna skip to some more technical stuff because that sounds like more fun to me. Give me 30 seconds. So far, so good? All right, if I get too deep, somebody will scream in pain or leave the room, and then I'll know. All right, let's just go straight to the meaty slide, and I'll talk to this slide for a while, because that's fun. Cloud Foundry itself under the hood is microservices architecture, right? So it's a bunch of different components. And I pointed out I'm at All Things Open and I'm using the Pivotal Cloud Foundry slide instead of the Cloud Foundry slide because I had no sleep. So the GUI part on the left there is a commercial product, so ignore the GUI. That's a super classic open source model, right? Open source plus you pay for GUIs. There's open source GUIs too. The 18F folks made one. I think Stark and Wayne made one. I mentioned NATs before. So at a very high level, we're ignoring Bosch in this diagram, right? So we say, okay, Bosch has this thing, but every one of these components is run by Bosch. So you start with, okay, I need a container running for my application. In fact, I want a bunch of containers. So we have container hosts that are called DEAs. They're actually getting renamed, but ignore that. Today they're called DEAs. And there's a pool of them that's managed and run by Bosch. And when an application is pushed, it says, okay, there's this pipeline that creates the container image, which I'll talk about in a second, and it gets scheduled onto one of those DEAs, and it gets started there. But getting traffic to that container requires a router. So there's a HA proxy load balancer and then a router on the outside of Cloud Foundry. If you think of it outside as incoming traffic. The router knows where all the containers are for every app. So it's sending traffic. So all traffic in and out of that system is going through the router and the HA proxy. Container images themselves, let's get into 12-factor a little bit here. All configuration for an application should come through environment variables, right? That's the like gold standard, and therefore you can use exactly the same application for dev and test and staging and prod and know that it's connecting to the right data services and never be making code changes during promotion because you're going to break things. So the building of that container image sets up the environment variables for it. And those environment variables include, how many of you have ever used Heroku? Okay, a couple of you. Typically, this connection to the database, let's think about a typical app. In fact, I should just probably push one. You guys mind if I just like fire up a little code demo? Yeah, it's more fun. Code is more fun than anything else. Let's look at, what have I got that's handy? Okay. I like to use this, and I'm not going to be able to see, which will be fun. I like to use this tool called Worker. which is a continuous deployment. Oh, I suppose I would need internet. That's going to suck. The internet doesn't really work, does it? All right. Let's not actually get totally derailed trying to get internet working. If it happens to work in a minute, so be it. So typically, I'd want a database in the back of my application. And so I need some credentials to connect to that database. Right? It might be MySQL. It might be Postgres. I don't ever want to know what those credentials are. First off, it's bad hygiene. Second, if they're different in production than they are in development, then I have to know two sets of credentials, and then I know the ones about the prod environment. So what I want is the internals of Cloud Foundry to know those credentials, set them as environment variables on the container when it's getting stood up and run, and change them as appropriate in different environments. And ideally, I don't even want to tell Cloud Foundry to run the app. I want my CI tool to do that, which is really easy to set up. And a lot of CI tools already have that integration. So if you're using Jenkins, it's a great Cloud Foundry plugin. If you're using Worker, there's a Cloud Foundry plugin, et cetera. If you, I really, really, really want internet. I love internet. I'm so optimistic, though. So if you have internet, if you have your laptops open, go to run.pivotal.io. There's a free trial of Cloud Foundry called Pivotal Web Services, provided by the folks at Pivotal. Why can I not get online? And you don't get the full experience. You don't get to play with Bosch there. So I'm really going to recommend that at some point you grab Cloud Foundry using Bosch Lite, which means you can set it up on your laptop using Vagrant, and you can learn what a Bosch manifest looks like and how you define what jobs are in which VMs and do a Bosch deploy yourself. And you don't have to use Bosch to push all of Cloud Foundry to get started. So I did a Bosch deploy to Amazon a couple of nights ago of Concourse, which is a really cool CI tool that's a new open source project that I'm going to use for my talk tomorrow. And I wanted to try it out. And so it's deployed and packaged as Bosch. I just want some Wi-Fi. Does anyone else have a hotspot I could borrow? Huh? I did try the conference Wi-Fi. It was like no love for me. Was it? OK. Well, I'll try it. Open 2015, right? If it connects at all. Yay. Optimistic. Optimism. 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 Woohoo! Okay. So I wrote, here's a simple example. Yeah, this one's actually static. That's not very interesting. Minipack is better. I have this silly website that I built for storing online promises. And it's an API that allows you to make a pact, a tiny pact, with another person. And you both log on using Twitter. And I was building infrastructure to deal with my ex-wife. And this seemed like a good idea. But it also seemed sort of generally useful. So I always set up new projects in Worker. And I like it because it's really simple to understand. And it's builds and deploys. Oh, yeah. I'm not deploying Minipack from this one. And it watches Git for commits to master, and then it runs the CI pipeline. If CI passes, it pushes to Cloud Foundry. There's basically everything I do now has some kind of Worker release for it. Where's Quench? Oh, it's a separate organization, which I can't quite see from here. There it is. Okay. So this one's a good example. This app has a bunch of other people working on it. It has a bunch of different deploy targets. So staging and dev and prod, they're all running on Cloud Foundry in different places. The fun thing about this is you can use exactly the same pipeline to deploy to, say, IBM Bluemix as you would to Pivotal Web Services, as you would to Cloud Foundry running on your laptop, right? So if you actually want to try a like quote unquote hybrid cloud thing, and to Azure, if I know Microsoft gives away free cloud like at every conference, so probably you guys have a couple tens of millions of dollars worth of free Azure credit. you just go use it. So what's going on under the hood here? If I could actually get to the, I can't quite see, sorry, it's embarrassing. There it is, that thing. The way Worker works is everything's environment variables. And I set up, I actually wrote the Worker steps for deploying to Cloud Foundry. And so they're ugly and they're open source and don't make fun of me. And so I specify the organization and the space that I want to target at the API layer. So if we think about Cloud Foundry for a second, what's actually happening under the hood here is there's a CLI tool, it's a CF, and it has a bunch of commands, and one of them is push. Right? So if you go into the folder full of your application code and you type CF space push, it's going to look at your code and say, oh, this looks like a PHP app, therefore I will use the PHP build pack. It will upload it towards the CF environment that you've targeted. It will make a container image out of your code plus the PHP build pack, which is basically the language and the framework, plus the root file system that's part of Cloud Foundry. And it will place that somewhere and start it and start routing traffic to it. It happens really fast. We could do one if you want. In fact, there's a static files build pack, which is literally like raw HTML. So I rage code sometimes. Like every time I'm sort of annoyed about something, I will build a website about it. So I was annoyed about 12-factor. And so I built a website about criticizing 12-factor. And I pushed it onto CF. And it's also continuously integrated. So if you disagree with something I said, you should send a pull request, because it's open source on GitHub. And I still have no internets. OK, I hate internets. I'm going back to my slides. Screw it. Screw you guys, I'm going home. So I mentioned lots and lots and lots of environment variables, right? The databases are connected with these environment variables. And so those credentials that you get created and passed into your app, when you do a CF push and you say CF push dash O for organization foo, it'll connect to a different database. And that's called service binding. It's an important concept. Services at a high level are like, hey, I want MySQL. A service instance is whatever abstraction the service provider wanted to give you. It might be a virtual machine, it might be an instance of MySQL, it might be a database on an instance of MySQL that's multi-tenant. It could be a whole cluster of VMs running MySQL just for your app. The service plan provides that level of detail, and the service broker, which runs as an app or runs in a VM, is in charge of starting up that service. So when you make this API call and says, give me a MySQL instance, it does whatever it thinks is the right thing to do to create that instance. Lots of different ways to provision services. They can be SaaS services. Maybe it just goes and creates credentials for you on Orchestrate. When that service is bound to your application, you're creating basically a record inside the Cloud Foundry database that says, oh, every time I create an instance of this app, a container for this application, I'm going to make sure the environment variables are inserted that allow it to connect to this service. So far, so good? All right. The brokering of services, by the way, is probably the most important feature of how platforms work. And the reason is devs want to think about development. Operations need to be able to control it in operations without having to constantly go back to devs. And that's, yeah, I mean, in a DevOps world, those are ideally the same people, and this problem doesn't exist. But a lot of the world doesn't live in that world yet. And a lot of the time, even I as a developer, I don't want to be always on the hook to manage my application. I like to hand it off to other people. And even if there are other developers, they still need to understand it in a different way. So that binding of like, hey, what, you know what, maybe the internet is actually going to work enough that I could do this from the command line. How would that be? I can't actually, oh, of course. I'm going to have, sorry. It's really annoying when you have apps that take over typical key bindings, like I want to make my font bigger and now I'm suddenly driving this stupid thing to make the volume louder. Okay, here's the CF CLI, right? And I can say what my CF target is. Okay, I'm attached to run.pivotal.io in the bean patch organization in the development space. And I might say, what are the apps running in there, which is going to require internet. Oh, yeah. CF login. This is always the part where I need to make sure I'm not echoing my password out in front of a room full of people, which I have done. It's very embarrassing. Okay, there we go. Targeting that space and org. All right, now let's see what apps are running in there. Oh, I got a bunch. Some of them are stopped. Some of them are started. I'm doing a thing called a blue-green deploy. How many of you have heard of that? Right, most of you. It's important. It's really, really easy to do in Cloud Foundry because the routes, AKA, hey, this domain name, are separate from the applications and the application instances. So when I stand up a new version, and I just, you'll see, I round robin between Quench A and Quench B, and Quench, actually. I just change the URLs that are going to resolve to it. So you'll see that, quench.cfapps.io is resolving to the Quench app right now, not Quench A or Quench B. I make a mess of those sometimes, but mostly the CI system drives it. And I have a really simple script that says which one's started, which one's stopped. Okay, do the new deploy as the stopped one, start it, point the route over there. If everything's good, stop the old one. And at any point if I want to roll back, I just start the old one and flip the route back. I actually can leave them both started and just flip the route back and forth, but it saves me if I stop it because then I'm not using up resources. All right, I was talking about services. So here are the services that are running. The Elephant SQL service is a MySQL database SaaS service. So the service broker for Elephant SQL is just creating and delivering credentials against somebody else's giant multi-tenant MySQL in the sky. And I have bound different apps. You can have multiple apps bound to the same service. And you can have the same name. So quench-dev as a database name, I could have that in the development space. I could have it named quench-dev in the testing space. So my code doesn't have to change. It's still expecting a database named the same thing with the same schema and same tables. But Cloud Foundry is going to deal with making sure the environment variables has different credentials connecting to a different database backend. The nice thing about this, there's this classic thing that says, use MySQL in dev and then use real Oracle in production. That never works. I mean, even trying to switch from MySQL to Postgres makes me want to kill people. You know, because there's some language format thing where the alter table format doesn't work against SQLite and Postgres the same way. And you're like, oh, that was half of my Sunday. Somebody needs to die. So it's really nice to say, hey, if I have to use Oracle in prod, I have to use Oracle in dev. So there's a service broker for Oracle XE. And you can just like literally spin up baby Oracles in a VM, use those in dev, and then connect same service binding, service brokering technology. The nice thing is service brokers don't have to point to cloud resources at all. Anything with a connection string. So you can write a service broker that points to that enterprise Oracle cluster in the basement. We've done service brokers for Informix, for DB2, for tandem nonstops. Like sooner or later, somebody's gonna do one for like a PDP-11. I swear, I don't know why you would, but somebody will. Okay, we're getting there? Making sense? Good pace? Okay, people are still awake. That's always a good sign. All right. There are a bunch of other things that you need to do when you're deploying apps, right? So you push an app, it connects to the database, and the first thing that happens inevitably is that something goes wrong, and your app throws a 500, and you're like, oh my God! How do I find out what's gone wrong? In the world of containers and VMs, this used to be, I guess I have to SSH into something. And I'll go SSH in, and then I'll tail-f var logs star something, multi-tail. You've all done this, right? I've done this for like years. So you don't do that anymore. What's really fun to do is CF logs. Let's say, delving, something, quench. Which one? I think it's just running as quench, right? Yeah, so now I'm tailing logs from quench. And if I go over here and I make some traffic, Is it this one? I have too many instances of this thing now. Yeah, I wish it was actually, I don't even remember which route it was. It's not that one. Oh, it is that one. I should probably make sure that this thing is even running before I start smacking on it. But let's assume. Not staging. Staging? No. I don't know. Okay. My internets are going to totally flake out and make me crazy. Yeah, it would be nice if I could load Google. And I hate internet. Anyway, the point is, log aggregation. Yeah, if you, yeah, thank you. Oh, perfect. All I want to do is generate something that makes the logs go, oh, look, there's my logs. Okay, thank you. So if I refresh over here, oh, except I need to know how to use Linux today. Control-R, F5, something, Control-R is good. The logs, I don't know if you see those refreshing in real time. Yeah. So the nice thing about log aggregation, and I'm going to harp on this because I have lived without this, and it makes me want to kill people. Most things you will find make me want to kill people. It aggregates all of the logs from all of the containers that are running that app and all of the logs from the router related to that application. So if you're saying, what's going wrong? I say, well, did the request hit the load balancer? Yes, I can see it in the logs. And I don't have to go SSH into the load balancer to figure it out. Did it come through the router and get directed to the right app? Yes, it did. I could see that in the same log stream, which, by the way, is coming through the CLI to my laptop. I don't have to SSH into anything. And then I, you know, and whatever level of granularity, this logging, by the way, is not just router logs. This is everything that comes out of standard out or standard error from your app in any language. So when you start thinking about microservices and you're like, okay, well, I don't just have, like, this one app in Java anymore. I have, like, 12 little apps in Node all talking to each other in REST interfaces. Okay, well, just this is how you get the logs out of it. Okay. I'm not aware of my timing. I go till 4:50, 4:55, something like that. I got half an hour? Okay. Thanks. I'm going back to this diagram for a second. We talked very briefly about build packs, and I haven't really walked through how the container images get put together, but I can do that in a second. I really want to make sure we cover some of these other things. I talked about log aggregation. There's also metrics collection. So when you think about that, you're like, oh, again, the hard problem is not my app is down or my app is up. The hard problem is 20% of the time my response time sucks. Why? What's driving that? So you have millisecond resolution for every request going in and out of that router. That data, the metrics data, is available as a Firehose API. And you can connect it to all sorts of APM tools. You can graph it with Graphite or Grafana or Elk or something. There's a little, actually, GUI demo somewhere. I don't actually know the URL offhand. Not enough sleep. But what it means is when you do a push, you do a CF push or a CF restage, and you see your error rate, your rate of, let's say, 500s, go from 0.02 to 0.1 in real time, you're like, let's roll that back. Because you did a blue-green deploy, you just do a CF routes change, CF unmap route, CF map route, and you watch your error rate go back down, and you're like, okay, I'm going to go troubleshoot that. Push that code to a different URL, and let me go beat on it with test traffic until I can figure out what's going on. But I've rolled it out of production. So the same pipelining for log aggregation works for metrics aggregation. Under the hood, if you want to get really dirty and confused, there's a custom protocol buffers protocol. There's a whole distributed systems architecture that has an arbitrary number of collectors. There's Doppler and Metrion. These are the two components you're looking for. And not only do you have the CF CLI, you have syslog, what are called nozzles and filters. So you can register a syslog endpoint that says only give me data about these apps versus give me data about all apps. So when you look at this kind of institutional operations approach, like, well, we just need a log drain that gets everything for archives. But then, like, actively, we care about the apps that are in production. And so let's only take logs out of that and store them in this log server, et cetera. Same for the metrics. All right. Health Manager. I talked a lot about how Bosch keeps track of VMs and whether or not they're running in the processes. Same kind of work is on top of what we call runtime, which is the container management. So if your container goes away, it notices, it launches a new one for you, starts routing traffic to it. We actually did a performance test, 1.6, which is a pivotal release number. We've switched the entire Elastic runtime container scheduler out for a newer one that we wrote. It's called Diego. Just ignore the names. Naming is horrible. We did a performance test where we had 300 containers running on 8 VMs on AWS. We killed 2 of the VMs. And the containers that had been running on those were rescheduled and replaced. So we killed, I don't know, 80 to 100 containers, something like that. They were replaced within 90 seconds. So up and receiving traffic again. Under load, we have, you know, major retailers that have run like holiday specials and stuff through Cloud Foundry. The Sundance Film Festival ran on CF this year. And we've had, you know, bad code been deployed to a single container. Oh, I skipped something important. That whole blue-green route thing, you can use that to round robin across different versions. You can have run route spreading traffic across app instances that are different versions of the code. So you can stand up and add a new version of the code and take it down again and put it up again. Take 20% of the traffic to one version and 80% to the rest of it. And they had done this and deployed bad code that was returning 500s that were being caught by the router, and the request was being resent to another app instance. So they had a performance degradation. They had increased latency, but no customer saw a 500. Like, we pushed bad code, and none of the users saw it. We got notified, and we went and turned it off again, but the users never saw 500s. Like, that's just exciting. Build packs. Oh, UAA. So another one of these important and annoying things is multi-tenancy, right? If you're actually going to run platform seriously, either inside a company or as a hosted service, you got to be able to deal with auth, authn, authz. And usually, it's not a matter of, I built a new user database, and so use this. So UAA is the user authentication and authorization system. Again, our names are horrible. And it's plugin based. So a lot of people use it, connect to LDAP. Right, you got Microsoft Active Directory, you got users and groups in there, great, give them permissions. There's fine-grained permissions on orgs and spaces. So if you have every developer in your team is allowed to go use the development space, that totally makes sense. Typically, the same way you might have a read-only master branch in GitHub, you might have read-only production, and the only user that has access to production would be your CI tools. Right, so the only way code gets to prod is through the tests, which I just like. That makes me super happy. NATS is the messaging bus. It's evil. We never should have written our own messaging bus. It will go away, and then we'll use real things like we should have done in the first place. But it works pretty well. There is some console inside there. There's some etcd inside there. There are some really fun mailing list threads and videos about why we had to stop using console and go back to etcd in spots. If any of you are familiar with Jepsen testing, consistency is a feature. Yeah, sorry. Okay, I did say I would talk a little bit more about build packs and how these container images get put together. So we use the term droplet for the actual container image. It's worth noting you can run Docker images using Cloud Foundry. People do it all the time. You do a cf push dash dash d or something, and you give it a Docker image instead of saying, here's my code. And it'll go run that for you. And you get most of the same features that you would get out of Cloud Foundry, too. So you still get log capture. You still get environment variable management. You still get routing and NHA. It doesn't do everything you would do with a Docker image. In other words, we're very opinionated about the one process, one port, one container philosophy. right? This is the sort of separation of concerns and ideal scaling model. So if you have a Docker image that has multiple processes or multiple ports, it's going to grab the first port and use that. We've got an approach to supporting, you know, child processes, but we can't monitor all the child processes. We're really only monitoring the parent process. So you lose some HA by going too far down the rabbit hole of tucking a whole bunch of stuff into one container. But the reason you would want to use build packs instead of a raw Docker image, and the Docker image for portability makes a ton of sense. If you're already using Packer and you've already got a CI pipeline put together to build Docker images, awesome. Use them. Just CF push those. If you're not, the reason to use build packs is because it makes it easy to deal with security vulnerabilities. So let's say you wrote an app in Java, and it's Java 6, and Poodle comes out, and you got to patch Java 6. You don't want to go in and rebuild by hand 50 different Docker images, or go find the dev teams and get them to do it, because they know exactly what went into them. If you were using the build pack, you just do a CF restage, right? So the build packs themselves are managed using Bosch. So you do a Bosch upgrade, which doesn't have any downtime. It does a canary deploy. It starts some new VMs and stops some old ones after the new ones are working. And so your new build pack becomes available, and you say, oh, restage my app, and it rebuilds it using the new build pack. So you didn't have to actually go and do one by hand. You didn't have to get the developers involved. Same for the root file system, right? So the operating system is actually, for each of those containers, it's the same, regardless of what language you have on top. There's a new version of the root file system for Cloud Foundry in OSS, like once a month right now at least, because there's a steady rate of security vulnerabilities in operating systems. And you gotta have one. And we just contrast that to, you know, a typical Docker registry where I think somebody did a scan of Docker Hub. It's like 30% of the images have vulnerabilities in them right now, just because people don't rebuild them. And so if you're using from some vulnerable image, you're kind of inheriting their vulnerabilities unless you're patching them yourself. And you don't want to own an Ubuntu image yourself. Like, it's not fun. There's no value in that. Anyway, if you are already doing it with a pipeline where you can click a, hey, rebuild, use Packer, awesome. That's why we support the format. Does that make sense? Build packs, lots and lots of build packs. I talked about app staging. How they, I mentioned the blobs. I said earlier Bosch actually compiles everything for you. When it compiles packages for you, it stores them in the blob store. It uses the API to say, hey, where's an object store? I'll store the blobs there. So it doesn't rebuild them for every VM, right? It compiles them once in that environment, in that IaaS, and then reuses them. But it saves them according to the version. So if you do a Bosch deployment with a new version of Postgres referenced, it's going to say, oh, I don't have that version, therefore I need to compile it. And I'll compile that one, and then I'll deploy that one. So you actually can do a code audit in a Bosch deployed environment that gives you the diff in every line of source code in every job running, which is insane. But, like, kind of cool. There are some government agencies that really like that feature. All right, I want to do Q&A, because Q&A is more fun than me rambling. And I don't think we really need to look much more at the rest of this. I'm going to skip forward and see if there's anything else super exciting I'm skipping. Oh, I didn't talk about scaling. A CF scale command is basically like a CF push, except it just makes more. So if you CF push an app and it's running, then you might CF scale 100, and you have 100 copies of it running. It's like, to a developer, it feels trivial. It's like, oh, that's cool. Now it takes more load. But to an operator, it's like, oh, that would have taken me like a day, maybe 2 days, go set up a whole bunch more environments for you and stand up a bunch more stuff. So I like scaling. You can do auto scaling. It's cool. We don't need to talk about containers. Everyone knows how containers work. Configuring and binding, we talked about that. You call these create service commands, and they pass off to the service broker that maybe reserves resources and gives you credentials. And then when you bind the service, other stuff happens. And then You get them back. All right, there's a recap. I would like to say maybe about governance. Just that would be closing on the open source side, because this is all things open. James Waters is the GM of Cloud Foundry at Pivotal, and he and I have been friends for a long time, from like before I started OpenStack, and he has mocked me continuously for how we organized OpenStack governance for like 5 years. And so when it came time to like set up an open source foundation for Cloud Foundry, he's like, let's just do it the opposite of whatever Josh did. Which is not exactly true, but it is fairly true. OpenStack, and this is, there's no pro or con here. These are both legitimate ways to run a community, they just have different objectives. So OpenStack, our goal was to have as many people as possible contributing. We wanted a huge big tent of like, every vendor in the world, come and do cloud here, this is the place where we're gonna do IaaS. Cloud Foundry, the barrier to entry is much higher. The goal basically is, if you're working on CF, you should be working full-time on CF. And so there are a lot less contributors by raw number, but a lot larger number of contributions per contributor on average. And partly that's because it's a more mature code base. It was like 4 or 5 years old by the time the foundation was set up. Partly that's because historically, Pivotal only does pair programming, and they only do actual test-driven development pair programming. So the Cloud Foundry community only does pair programming, which means really to be effective as a contributor, you've got to go to one of the offices, one of the dojos where Cloud Foundry development is going on. And IBM has some, and HP has some, and EMC has some, and Pivotal has some. And then there's some community contributors who don't contribute full time and still send pull requests and still have a lot of code accepted, but they're less involved in governance. So the governance is really organized around full-time contributors. I don't know if this is like a positive or a negative, there are both in that, right? So it's a much higher bar, but it also means the folks who are that invested feel like they have a say that's commensurate with how much work they're putting in. Yeah, I think that's it on the governance side. Let me take a bunch of questions, or one question, or 10. Yeah.
You just mentioned that using the CF route, you can split the traffic like 50-50, 20-80, but I didn't see any CRI parameters that I can split traffic programmatically, or is just some I have to specify how many instances to split the traffic in the way you describe.
Good question. So how do you split percentage of traffic with the router? So in the current version of CF, yeah, you just run more app instances of one version than another, and you get commensurate amount of traffic. There's a beta of route services now coming out in 1.6. It's out in the open source now that allows you to do more sophisticated things with traffic shaping. And there's a demo of an integration with Apigee using that beta. Oh, that sounds really obscure. Came out last week. So there's also now more sophisticated routing in terms of context path routing as opposed to just domain name routing. So we're doing like there's a lot happening in the community around that space. If you get super crazy with how much you want to do in terms of round-robining different amount of traffics, a lot of people still put like an HA proxy in front of it and do sophisticated provisioning there. You can also, because of route services, you can switch on any arbitrary headers, right? So maybe you want to do global DNS kind of stuff or switch on different IP addresses or session versus no session, that kind of thing. He's loud. He's got his speakers turned way up. You got another question? Yeah.
So if you have applications in the cloud, right? If you have some sort of service being more requirement of like network bandwidth between two applications.
Mm-hmm.
Does CF help guarantee that or monitor that or alarm you if that's pretty valid?
It's a great question. So the question is, if you have two applications running in Cloud Foundry and you need a minimum amount of bandwidth in between them, what does CF do for you? So there is a whole set of folks interested in using Cloud Foundry for NFV, Network Function Virtualization, which is kind of a telecommunications specific use case. Huawei is a member of the Cloud Foundry Foundation, and I think they're very interested in this. And there are a lot of big telcos using CF in different ways. I don't think there's that much in it today. And the reason is, I don't want to whine about SDN, but I'm going to whine about SDN. SDN is amazing in theory and horrible in practice today. And so it's really hard for the PaaS layer to expect anything other than basic reachability and IP from a generic interface. And Bosch has to stay generic. We're like, if we're going to make calls to infrastructure as a service networking, we have to know that's going to work across Amazon and vSphere and OpenStack and Azure, at least. So we could say, oh, well, if we did a deal with VMware and we used NSX, we could do really cool things that wouldn't work in Amazon. And we're not going to do that. So right now, there's a bunch of container networking proposals that have been floating around in the Cloud Foundry community. Some of them have been like, hey, let's use Project Calico. Let's use OVS. Let's use Contrail. And then there are individual Cloud Foundry deployments. So GE uses Contrail with Cloud Foundry. Swisscom uses PlumGrid with Cloud Foundry. There's NSX deployment. There's all sorts of people doing all sorts of stuff. There's Project Calico in it at Bloomberg. I think the community as a whole can't really go much farther until there's some level of minimum bar that we could say, oh, here's the APIs we're going to use for QoS. Right now, that's like very vendor specific in every case. It's frustrating. But I think we'll get there at the same time as the rest of the world gets there with SDN, which is sometime in 2050.
Real soon now.
Real soon now. Do you want to introduce yourself?
No.
Just put you on the spot. Chris sits on the Cloud Foundry Foundation board, so he's keeping me honest here. Any other questions?
I'm curious about the application debugging experience.
For example,
you develop one application, and there's a memory leak report from your APM, but what Cloud Foundry can help?
Yeah, so debugging. This is a great question, comes up all the time. In the Java world, we have really good JMX connectivity. So there's a bunch of folks who've done things with connecting, debugging servers using ngrok and JMX. In 1.6, there's support now for SSH to the container. I hate telling people that that's in there because I think it's an anti-pattern to use. I mean, it's an anti-pattern to use from your keyboard. It's not an anti-pattern to allow tools to use. And that essentially, if you can do an SSH to the container, you can do whatever debugging might be required if you can figure out which container you need. Other than JMX and APM, so there's integrations in the community or commercially with New Relic, Dynatrace, AppDynamics. Some of those give full instrumentation and sort of give more debugging capabilities. Others are more traditional APM. Some of them are language specific. Some of them are agentless. So there's a whole range of stuff happening there. And I actually think there's a couple of different Eclipse plugins too. I know there's an Eclipse plugin and an IntelliJ plugin, at least for some of the basic stuff. Beyond that, like on the Pivotal side, we've done a lot of integration with Spring Cloud, which is the whole Netflix OSS suite. It's like Eureka and Hystrix and Ribbon and Zool. So using Hystrix for debugging is really interesting when you get into microservices. And that's very popular in the Cloud Foundry community, but it's not part of Cloud Foundry. It just fits well together. I wish there was like a magic way to debug that wasn't language specific, but at a certain point, debugging outside of like logs and APM is still language specific. Okay, I'm gonna make a plug for my talk tomorrow because it has nothing to do with Cloud Foundry. If those of you who might be weirdly interested in government, the effort of getting a certification and accreditation to run software in government has been like the nightmare of bureaucracy since the beginning of time. It's called red tape. And so there's a community effort now to automate a bunch of red tape. Using Cloud Foundry is sort of the example we're doing first. So I'm going to talk about that for like 20 minutes tomorrow. And it's a keynote, so you'll probably be there anyway. But that's going to be fun. And I think there's other exciting things like that happening in the Cloud Foundry community. One other proviso, I guess. There are a ton of people using CF and a ton of people contributing to it. It is one of the most invisible open source communities I've ever seen because they're pair programming. And it's a weird side effect, but paired developers are not on IRC and they're not on Slack. And they don't answer email except for like two or three times a day. So they feel like as a trying to get into the community, it's actually hard. Because you're like, I tried to email this guy and he didn't answer and nobody's on IRC and what's going on? Well, that's why. It's because they're literally paired up all the time. The product managers do a really good job of answering requests, and there's now a mailing list for all of the open source Cloud Foundry product managers, which I think got finally set up earlier this week. So like, it might feel weird as a developer to be like, why would I go talk to a product person? I usually would just talk to an engineer. But that's why, because the engineers actually won't hear you. Like, they're mind melding. So if you want to get involved in Cloud Foundry, like, although it will feel strange, it's not IRC. This is not an IRC-driven community. This is a, like, go email the PMs, and they will help you figure out who to talk to. But they do like to talk, and they do take pull requests. Pull requests. All right, thank you everyone for listening. I know that was pretty long and rambly and stuff, but I hope it was useful, and I'll be up here if you want to ask a couple questions at the end. I'm giving you like a couple extra minutes back. Until next time.